I selected the topic food security and role of research is a broad subject, not any specific to horticulture or agriculture or crops or livestock. So everyone has been talking at the national level, at the regional and international level, food security and nutrition security. Plans are being prepared, which ended in the 2015. The goals wanted that the hunger and malnutrition should be halved by year 2015. While some countries were able to reduce their hunger and malnutrition, but India was not able to meet the goals of the Millennium Development Goals. So now we have the Sustainable Development Goals. Why are you so much worried about the food security and nutrition security? Because the population is increasing. Impacts of climate change that will have a terrific impact on the agriculture production, food production. And we have been talking of eradication of hunger. I'll be talking a little about that. And also we have been talking about the nutritional security. Even within India, our Prime Minister has been talking about plans up to 2022 and 2030. Lord Buddha has said, the greatest disease of all humankind is hunger. So without, unless you are able to solve the problem of hunger, there cannot be a peace in the world. Prevalence of hunger and poverty and malnutrition has been very prevalent. The global population, which was about 1.5 billion in 1900, has grown to about 7.3 billion now and expected to reach cross 9.5 billion by year 2050. Out of this, about 850 million people are hungry. They go to bed every night without enough food and undernourished or malnourished. In addition to that, more than 2 billion people, that means only nearly one third of the global population, suffer from malnutrition, and some people call it as hidden hunger. Each year, 5.5 million children die of hunger and starvation. 5.5 million people each year are dying. 1 billion people live on less than a dollar a day, which is equivalent to about 60 rupees per day. And out of this, 700 million are in Asia, and nearly 80% of them are in India. So if you look at the malnutrition, and out of a world population of 7 billion, about 2 billion are undernourished, as I said, that means nearly one third of the population is undernourished. Like that, adults worldwide are undernourished and improperly managed. 159 million underage 5 are too short for their age, and things like that. So why is it happening? In age where so much science has developed, we were able to send a man to the moon, but we are not able to feed our own population here in this country. So when you talk about 850 million population are undernourished, where are this population? As you can see here, nearly 578 million of this undernourished population is in Asia, and major portion of them are in India. Now recently, the International Food Policy Research Institute has released the Global Hunger Index. You can see that India, the starvation is very severe. And as I said, out of 119 countries, India is ranked as number 100. We have moved from ship to mouth in 1960s to be an exporting country now. In spite of that, so many people are not able to feed themselves. Where are these people, 850 million people we are talking? 50% of the hungry are in smallholder farming households and 20% among the landless. Farmer, smallholder farming, and specifically mentioned we be here, the smallholder farms are the people who make us supply the food to us. 80% of the global production, whether it be rice, whether it be wheat, or fish, or livestock, comes from the small scale farming. But they themselves are not able to survive with the farming activities they are talking about. World has resources and knowledge, but continuing situation is a travesty of the food fundamental human right to proper food. So why is it this happened? Don't we have the technology to increase the production? So let us look at it, those points why we are talking about. Now if this is the situation now, about a billion people are starving, when the population goes to 9.5 billion people by year 2050, what will be the situation with regard to the starvation and food security. So people were estimating by different agencies, international agencies, and also at the regional and national level, estimates are being made as to what will be the food demand by year 2030 and 2050. So this demand for food will be coming from the increasing population and also urbanization in the developing countries, and thirdly from the increasing influence because of economic growth and people have more purchasing power. Once you have more money, that you like to have more nutritious food. If you look at the population that we are talking about, global population is crossing about 9.5 billion by 2050. Same thing with India, we were about 375 million only in 1950. Now we have crossed about 1.2 billion and by 2050 we will be crossing about 1.6 billion people. So where is this increasing population is happening? The green lines, bars show the population increasing in the developing countries, and the black indicates the increasing population in the developed countries. You could see here, hardly there is an increasing in population in the developed countries, but almost 95% or 99% of the increasing population is in the developing countries, where it is food security is going to be a big issue to meet the increasing demand from the increasing population. The second issue that is impacting on the availability of food is the urbanization. In 1960s, one-third of the global population is in the urban areas and two-thirds of the population was in the rural areas. But by 2030, that means in another 12 years, it is expected the situation will reverse. Two-thirds of the population will be in urban areas and only one-third of the population will be in rural areas. It has two impacts, repercussions. If people are migrating from rural areas to urban areas, that means there is less people for agriculture and crop production and other food commodities. Two, when they are migrating to urban areas, they are putting more pressure on the food basket. The third aspect they were talking about, economic growth. For example, in 2009, the middle class population was only 525 million. By 2020, the middle class population is expected to increase to 1.7 billion. That means within a span of 11 years, the middle class population is increasing by 3 times. And by year 2030, it should be middle class population will increase by 6 times. What does it mean when you are talking about food security? As income growth increases, income increases, there will be more demand for food. Not only in quantity, but also in quality. People will look for more proteinous food, more health food. So because of these three reasons, there will be heavy demand and the food production. So this is another slide to show that in Asia Pacific region is a place where the maximum economic growth is taking place in the next 10 to 15 years time. So when we talk of the future demand for food, where from is this coming? Again here, the black bars indicate the food demand from the developing countries, and whereas the green bars indicate the food demand from the developed countries. You could see here the demand, increasing demand from the developed countries is not much, but much of the demand for food increase over the years will be in the developing countries. So because of this, the world's resources are limited, but whereas the population growth, rising affluence, that is increasing incomes, and also some of these food grains are being diverted for production of ethanol. So the Food and Agriculture Organization and many other institutions have done estimates what will be the food demand for year 2030 and 2015. FAO says that the food has to production, food production has to increase by nearly 60 to 70% by year 2050, and that means again all this 60 to 70% increase in food production, as I said, has to come from the developing countries where the demand is more. So somehow this one, cereal production has to increase by nearly 50%, meat production has to increase from 200 million to 470 million tons, fish production to increase by 40 to 15 million tons. That means we are asking for about 30 to 40% increase from now to year 2030. And where from this increased fish food production will come, 60 to 70% increase that we are talking is needed to meet the growing demand. FAO estimates that 80% of this increase in food production has to come through intensification, only 20% from increase in area, because already land and water are in short supply, and so we have to intensify our production without impacting on the environment. So what are the threats for the future demand? As I said, urbanization, declining resources, land, water, and productivity, as the inauguration that the Chief Secretary has said, we talk of the green revolution, all it has also already the impact on that, soil productivity has gone down. So also the water, I will talk about later on, and impact of the climate change and diversion of the cereals for the biofuel. So just increasing the production, will it solve the problem of food security and nutrition security? Because even if the food is available in the market, unless people have the purchasing power, they will not be able to resolve the problem of food security and nutrition security. And the reverse. We have overexploited, like we have overexploited our soil. We have overexploited our natural water resources, like the seas and the water. Now we have only 10% of what was there in 1960, a population, fish population. And even to retain the 10% of the fish population that we have now in our seas and in the rivers, it will be gigantic talk. Because we have been very greedy, we are not bothered about the sustainability. We can see a small net operated in a river, see the amount of fish that has been caught and the size of the fish that has been caught. That means we are not allowing the young fish to grow and reach the market side. Before that, we are exploiting and killing them. These are some of the traps kept in the rivers. This is like a tea filter, you know. It filters everything from the egg to the larva to the big fish. So everything is taken up from our natural water resources. So that's what we call as fishing down the marine web. That means in the past, high value fish and big size of fish, we have already overexploited them. Now at the end of the arrow, it's uneconomical, small size fish that we are able to catch now, because we are not cared about the sustainability. We have been too greedy and we have been catching everything that was available to us. So what, there are a number of questions to reverse the trend. On one side we have the production, on the other side we are not able to address the food and nutrition insecurity. So what needs to be done? Produce enough at affordable prices to keep people away from hunger. What technological innovations are needed to increase production from declining resources? That is what we are talking about. Are we investing enough in research and development? Do we have an efficient technology for transfer technology system in our place? Do we have adequate policies and again a political will to address the issue of the small farmers so that we can address the issues of hunger and malnutrition? As I said, as the global agriculture, 80% of the global agriculture production comes from small-scale farmers. Even in India also, more than 80% or even 90% of the production, food production, comes from small-scale farmers. So my question all through my career has been, are we delivering the new technologies to the farming community in the right way to do that, in a profitable, sustainable, resilient system? I think probably there is a big gap between research and development. I said we have excellent research institutions, agriculture universities and colleges, but to my knowledge, much of this knowledge is not percolating into developmental activity. That is something I think we have to relook at, and in fact I have been telling the Indian Council of Agriculture this is a drawback, because I am on the quinquennial review teams and research advisory committees of some of the ICAR institutions. Then I find that they are always Then research focus on disease resistance, because we have to intensify our production from the existing natural resources. That means that will lead to more diseases and less efficient feeds in the livestock and fisheries, where we have the efficient feeds and fertilizers and input supply to the farmers. And we have been talking of use of biotechnology and genetic enhancement I met Norman Borlaug in 2005 when I received the World Food Prize, and this is one of the things that we have been talking about, reaching to the farmers. We are able to eat it today because of Norman Borlaug, the father of the green revolution. So we are talking about biotechnology and genetic enhancement. Just I am taking from the animal sciences. When compared to 1940, by 2010, chicken production has increased by 350%. Swine production has increased by nearly 250%. Beef cattle production, of course, has not increased that much. So this was all possible because of the genetic improvement. Of course, we are talking the GMOs now. So this is some sort of research that has to be done. Again, not doing the research, but again, that has to percolate to the farming community. So another gap I find in our Indian research system is much of our research is focused on biological aspects. Very little in care is given or importance is given social sciences, economics, cultural aspects, markets and marketing, and policies. For example, take our small scale farmer. When the drought is there, he's a loser. When it is a good crop, the market dips and he's not able to make money. In either case, he is easy. So probably this is an area where we have to increase our research output. Then when I am thinking, there are lots of policy areas where research is needed, but I am thinking just from one area. When we talk about providing more, what are we talking, providing from the vegetable protein or the animal protein? Of course, we need both animal and vegetable protein. If you talk about the animal protein, we want to take it for increase beef production, or we want to increase the pork production, or we want to increase the poultry production, or we increase the fish sector to grow. So there are some implications for that, for a policy decision to be taken. If you look at the protein consumption, as incomes increase, protein consumption increases. So on the left side are all the developing countries where the protein consumption is very low, whereas on the right side are the developed countries where the protein consumption is high. It is to be expected because per capita income is higher in the developed countries. They can afford to buy animal protein as compared to the developing countries where the per capita incomes are very low. Now again, example, a very interesting study has been done. Within the animal protein, you can see a difference in the developed and developing countries. In the developing countries, low-income group countries, more protein comes from the fish than compared to the developed countries. So that means people could afford to buy fish, which is cheaper than the poultry or beef or the pork. So when you talk about the policies, where the limited resources the governments are to be invested, whether we should go for the poultry or beef or industry, we have to look at it. And also, if you look at the feed consumption, feed conversion of fish, chicken, pork and all that, fish again is a better converter of feed, because feed for the animals is going to be a big problem. Not only the human food, but also the feed for the animals is going to be a big problem in the coming years. Likewise, conversion efficiency is very high, emissions are the lowest in case of the fish. So taking into all these considerations, the environmental, the availability of resources and all that, the government has to decide which where they will put, try to put their action to that information. So these are some of the nitrogen and phosphorus emissions. You can see beef is the, beef production is the highest emission force, then comes the fish, chicken and the bivalve. Let me again, you look at the water use efficiency. To produce 1 kilo of beef, you need 1 ton of water. In case of pork, you need about 280 liters of water to produce. So chicken like that and the fish in the case it becomes small. So when water is going to be a deficient factor in the future, so the policymakers also have to look at it where they want to make the animal protein available from them. So as I said again, the research extension farmer linkages are very weak. That is an area where we need to do more research and also the change some of the existing policies and policy and governing issues. And in case of ICR institutions and agriculture universities, you know, these are time-bound research projects, 3 to 5 years, and the project is over, everything is over. What is left is the report and scientific publication. How far these research results are being taken to the developmental agency, nobody cares for that. I have seen a number of cases where all the reports are lying there, but no action taken beyond the project period. Also last, I think, more practical orientation in the universities is needed. This, I have been putting this one because when I was touring some of the areas in Andhra Pradesh, the fish farms and all that. We are getting technicians from China and Thailand. They're high school graduates, but they have the practical experience they went to the master. Those foreigners doesn't believe on our agriculture graduates or fisheries graduates. They said, they have the theoretical knowledge, but practical knowledge is new. So they are bringing people from, even from Bangladesh, some people have come to teach our farmers and aquaculture farms. So there, I think an orientation is needed in the agriculture university. So the teaching is more practical than theoretical. And just to put lastly, a quote from Mahatma Gandhi, the difference between what we do and what we are capable of doing would suffice to solve most of the world problems. Thank you very much.